BM to the PM, PM to the AM foam. Piss out your per diem, you just gotta hate them foam. If I quit your BM, I still rock Mercedes foam. If I quit this season, I still be the greatest funk.
My left stroke just went viral.
Right stroke, put a baby in a spiral. Soprano C, we like to keep it on the high note.
Welcome to another episode of Coach's Corner. This is number 48, I believe. Don't fact check me on that. This is all just off the cuff situation here. With me as always, Trevor Jaffe, the greatest co-host in all the land.
All right, that's gaining momentum. I like that. Now we've moved from co-host to the greatest co-host.
Oh yeah, because you co-host two podcasts. Because Riley clearly runs the other one.
She's got so much more tech savvy than me and a much better speaker. I don't even know why I'm here. just give her the microphone and let her go.
Because it's better to talk to someone than to talk to yourself.
Yeah, that's just true. I was talking about this before we got online, my little tantrum where I'm like yelling at myself in the gym when I was training today. So that's true. Usually if I'm talking to myself, it's not a good thing.
Well, yeah, it is. It is something that's always interesting because if you read a lot of these books about self-reflection and self-awareness, the idea of running ideas and thoughts through your head on a continuous basis, continually having conversations with yourself, it's normal. But yeah. If you see a homeless person talking to himself out loud, all of a sudden they have issues. You're like, wait a minute.
It's only normal if you internalize if you externalize it, you're batshit crazy.
Right, for sure. And it's like, oh, interesting concept for sure to think of it that way. You know, but I was I had somebody comment on one of my posts the other day. I think it was yesterday. And it was one of the educational posts that I did talking about intra-workout carbs.
Okay.
Which was like, I don't know, it was like 10 weeks ago. And I was like, okay, this long post telling me pretty much how I'm wrong. And I was like, sweet. He even has some good literature to back it up. And I'm like, okay, fair enough. That's your literature. Here's my literature. He did it in a nice way. So I'm not trying to rag on the guy because he might listen to the podcast. I don't know. But he did it in a way that was like, let's have a talk about this because what you're presenting clearly doesn't back it up. And I was like, fine, that's okay. So he gave me his studies and then I gave him my thought process and some more studies to back that up. And I was like, all right, you know, maybe we're done. I hate this long form written dialogue on Instagram that can start. That's why I never post on Facebook. And that's why I try not to post too many things that can allow people to have opinions on Instagram. Cause it's like constant back and forth. Cause I try to say everything with like the idea of having an open mind, like no black and white answers, no binary answers so that people can interpret it for what it is so that there isn't this back and forth conversation because I don't have all day to fucking talk to you. I mean, I'm sure you're a great person, but I have shit to do.
We've talked about it before on the podcast, and it's not gospel. You know, it's the literature, right. And it's almost like an outline. Science is finding an outline what's most effective, right. Most often effective.
Yeah. So that's what I'm getting at, right? Like, so I write back to him, and I was like, okay, this will probably be it. This will end it for sure. No, it didn't end it. He came back with some more literature, and I was like, oh, this is going to just be a back and forth literature. this is going to really be a waste of time. And, you know, his literature was good. I mean, valid points for sure. And I just asked him, I was like, hey, man, have you ever tried intra-workout drinks? He's like, yeah, you know, I tried Extend before. Ooh. And I was like, what'd you think of that? He's like, well, I felt better. And I felt
that's
like
just electrolytes, caffeine, and a couple of amino acids.
Right. And I was like, I felt like I felt better. Like I performed better, recovered better. I felt good. I was like, huh. So you're just going to allow. And then he's also like, yeah. And I always hear coaches like you and John Meadows and Jeff Nipper talk about how intra-workout is extremely valuable. I'm like, huh. So you tried it. Felt like it worked for you. All the coaches you respect, they recommend it. But because the literature doesn't back it up, you're just going to be like, well, fuck that. You know, it worked for me, but yes. If the literature told me it's not going to work. So all of a sudden I'm not even going to do it. I'm not even going to try it. I was like, hey man, just try it. Just try it. See what happens.
It's the opposite of the placebo effect. He has the nocebo effect. He's convinced himself it cannot possibly work, even though anecdotally he felt fucking better.
Right. And then I was like, none of the research points that it's detrimental. Research at the very least favors the idea that it might have some type of benefit. But it has no detrimental benefits. Maybe just try it, right? Like, fuck, don't be so blind. And that's the those are the people that get so dogmatic into the research where it's like, oh, well, this volume landmark study came out. So now I have to do 40 sets a week of every muscle group in order for me to grow optimally. It's like, what? What? Just because Brad Schoenfeld came out with a study and he's well respected does not mean that that's the gospel. And he'll say that too. Yes. That it's not the gospel.
He's talked about it. I've seen some other people post about it. And it's like a bad scientist believes his studies. A good scientist tries to disprove himself.
Yeah, yeah.
So they're always questioning it. They should be trying to
Albert Einstein?
It probably was. And you know me with quotes, I just can't remember who said it, but I remember reading it somewhere. And that's what he was talking about, is not getting confirmation bias, but trying to prove yourself wrong is what a good scientist should do.
Right.
So if you have a belief system, you should be going out of your way to try and prove yourself wrong. And it's one of those things where literature can show so many different things. There's studies. I mean, you know, let's look at creatine. Creatine is something that the overwhelming majority of studies have shown effectiveness, but there are some studies that show an ineffectiveness, and we don't necessarily know why, but there's like two or three that may say it did nothing, but there's like 97 that said it did something. So the consensus is it does something. That's the consensus. But if you're only looking at those three studies, you're going to say, no, it does nothing. And that's what this guy's kind of guilty of, is looking at these particular studies. He's cherry picking his research. Like you said, you're going back and forth, and there's no convincing him otherwise because the three studies he's holding say otherwise.
So right.
It's like, it's just, there's some people who are non-responders. It doesn't mean it's you. It's just some people are non-responders.
And that's the way I look at any research, right? It's like you accept the things that disprove what you believe, because you don't want to have confirmation bias. You don't want to just find the research that tells you what you want to hear. Just like you don't want to have people in your life that always pat you on the back and tell you how awesome you are when you're fucking
up. No, actually, I want more of them. It's really good for my ego to have a few more of them.
You don't want yes men in your life, especially when you're fucking it up, you know? So it's like, okay, the studies, like I said, the studies he presented made sense. I like them. They were good. But that doesn't mean just because you found studies to show one thing that the studies that showed another thing are irrelevant and they're not good anymore. And all of a sudden, you know, when you have someone like Tipton, who is one of the leading researchers in protein and workout stuff, intra-workout carbohydrates and protein, mostly protein, have studies that kind of say, hey, this is a good thing, even if it is in untrained individuals. I'm going to lend myself to thinking that. The sports nutrition books that I have that are all at the college level, you know, they'll talk about all the studies and intra-workout and carbohydrates and stuff. And they'll say, you know, it might be a decent idea maybe to just try it, because there's no studies that point to it being negative. The only one that he quoted one that had a negative effect, it created more cortisol than the group that just had water alone. And that's because they had 86 grams of carbs. So they probably had some type of GI distress.
I was about to say stomach distress is the only thing I've seen for people who do too high of a carb load, which is how Gatorade was formatted, because they realized that if it was at a certain point, it caused gastric distress. So they diluted it to 7% or less.
So it's, you know, the way I look at it is the way I look at a lot of things. If I think it works and there's a little bit of research to back it up, I'm going to try it and hope to God that placebo effect takes over if it doesn't work, and at least get some type of positive benefit out of it. Because, you know, if there's nothing to show that it's negative, then why not try it, you know?
Sure.
But yeah, so it was an interesting thing. And that's why I fucking hate like long form posts.
I don't know if you ever saw, there was an argument online years ago. This is back when like Facebook was more popular. But John Kiefer, who had did like the carbonite solution and carb backloading, was involved in the sport for a little while through Brian Carroll. But somebody was arguing with him about the science, and then they put all those studies he shows in his carb backloading book, and it was like 10-year-old kids with rickets in India. Like, it just didn't apply to athletes in any way, shape, or form.
Yeah.
It was like the best example of cherry-picking research that I'd ever seen. It was really funny.
Yeah, for sure. And I always recommend, you know, you should have references to what you're trying to say, right? Mm-hmm. And if you talk to any researcher worth their weight in gold, they'll tell you immediately that science tends to be maybe 2 to 3 years behind the real world professionals and what they're doing. The professionals allow the scientists to ask the questions. Good scientists follow the professionals that are really good at what they do to formulate the questions. And that's just, I mean, I can't just blindly say, hey, I'm not going to do something because science says it doesn't work, when all these other coaches say it does work, like injectable L-carnitine. I've heard nothing but great things about that, you know, but science would say, hey, carnitine may not be the best thing. It may not pass through the blood-brain.
But it's dealing with oral ingestion versus, you know, intramuscular or subcutaneous. And there's so many different factors at play. It's like if someone is trying something with an athlete or multiple athletes and are getting success from it, you have to then question why they're getting success. And either you try it yourself and you're your own N1 study, or you wait for actually, like you said, 2 to 3 years behind, sometimes even more. You know, sometimes well beyond that, we don't know what's effective. I mean, look at how many years people were selling branched chain amino acids only to then be saying that they're bunk. And then there's now new research coming out that can show in certain situations, branched chains actually are anti-catabolic, like severe burn victims. They give them like IVs and that helps preserve tissue and muscle mass and so forth. Ideally, that's obviously condition dependent. It's not going to mean going to the gym is going to be the same as being a burn victim, but you're throwing the baby out with the bathwater. There was use for it, which was very conditional dependent. So yeah. Intra-workout's kind of the same thing. If you're working out for only 45 minutes, that's not that intense. It's probably not going to benefit you. If you're working out in hard elements for an hour and a half or a long period of time, it probably would benefit you. You know,
I mean, and that's the thing, right? Is being able to extrapolate like the averages that come from science, because they're never, you know, show me a science paper that's gonna tell me how to get an 800-pound squat. Oh wait, that's never gonna happen. Show me a science paper that's not a case study on how to get shredded to step on stage. Oh wait, that's never gonna happen, because the best athletes in the world aren't going to those places to do their to just give them free reins to do whatever they want, you know? And it just irks me, because it happens in class too, where a professor be like, hey, this study is a great study, blah, 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 blah. Then everyone's like, oh yeah, this is the best thing. This is what I'm going to go with. And then it's like, just, hey, pump the brakes, guys. Don't change, you know, years and years of success based off of one thing that you heard from a respectable person, because they can do a study the very next year to try to build upon that. And it shows absolutely no correlation or no positive effect at all. You know, so it's just educated guessing a lot of times when it comes to that. But I just thought that was interesting. Something I wanted to bring up with the whole, you know, evidence-based practice being very popular now. I think that it's a great route to go, right? Let science kind of lead the way. You don't want to be a fucking idiot and do stupid shit and not actually take in science at all. But you don't want to be so far on the science side, because last time I checked, and I don't know, maybe they're hiding somewhere, but I've never seen a scientific person, professor, fucking have a 2,000-pound total or be an IFBB pro bodybuilder or, you know.
Just Jared Skinner. Shout out to Jared, because he's got a 2,000-pound total and a PhD in biomechanics. So he's the outlier.
Yeah, but he's actually doing like research that's going to affect like the world in a whole. Where it's like, I just want to do research on people that want to perform better. It's a research that doesn't get a lot of funding and doesn't get a lot of recognition and doesn't help too many people, where Jared's actually trying to help change the world. So good for him.
Yeah, and you know what's ironic with that is sports performance, nutrition, supplementation, healthcare. These are the things that the globe is spending the most amount of money on. And the things that like Jared's researching is like almost none, unless you actually have like multiple sclerosis or neurological disorders. We almost have that science backwards.
No, very much so. But they get the funding to do the stuff, so it's good.
Yes.
We just spend all our money on the other stuff that doesn't really have much of an effect. But
nice labeling packaging though.
The packaging's sweet.
Yeah. See, look, I'm currently supporting the military with my military branded Bang energy drink. So there you go.
Oh man, that could also be pro, you know, whatever else. People can find that can and be like, take it into whatever context they want, and all of a sudden you're a neo-Nazi.
I'd be the first Jewish neo-Nazi, that's for sure.
It's true. It's a good way. You're like the spy of spies.
Well, I can't wait for that person to call me out online for being a neo-Nazi. And I'm like, what part of my heritage indicated that to you?
Well, he could also be the person that doesn't believe that the Holocaust happened too.
Oh, they're out there. It's crazy.
Those nutbags. Anyways, on to some questions. We have some pretty good ones, I will say. Thanks for all the questions, guys. First one up is pretty much a guy saying that he just doesn't like the way you use your words. The past couple episodes, I've heard you all comment on the whole, I just misgrooved the lift. And first off, I don't like being bunched in with the comments. And this seems to happen all of a sudden. It's like, oh, Trevor and Tony have a podcast together. All of a sudden, whatever Trevor says, Tony automatically is involved with.
It's vice versa. You pick on a lifter or a coach outside the show, and next thing you know, I get hate mail from them or hate posts from them. It's vice versa.
It is true. It is true. We've lost many friendships over the friendship that we have. But yeah, he was talking about how the concept of just misgrooving the lift, and how it's really about being too weak to hold the position is what our thing is, right? Like, yep. People don't misgroove a lift. They're just too weak to hold that position, or technical deficiencies or breakdown. And he was saying that you have people that will miss their first and second attempt, which is just ridiculous, and then hit it on their third, and it probably moves way better than their first or second attempt, right? Obviously, because they completed it, duh. Right. But anyways, what's going on there? He wants to know, like, what's going on there. If we don't think that they're misgrooving the lift, and then all of a sudden they come back, you know, like the mom lifting the car off the baby because they just, you know, got to get that lift in. You know,
she should power lift for sure.
She should. Only if the baby's going to get crushed if she misses the weight.
We could arrange that and make the sport much more exciting.
Yeah. I think that would bring in a lot of hate mail. But yeah, what's going on?
So there's some context there that matters. Like, sometimes people will miss on a technicality and they come back and get their second and third, like their butt pops off the bench or they rack before the rack command. So that negates the whole thing right there. That's complete bullshit. And other times we always talk about it. It is a misgroove because your success is found in the setup. You didn't maintain and hold or set up properly for that rep. Maybe you rushed, maybe you were nervous, maybe whatever. But if your setup breaks down, your technique breaks down, then you weren't strong enough to hold it. And it's why I always talk about, from bar to PR, you should be using the exact same technique. It shouldn't just be something that you set up better because it's heavy weight. You should set up for the empty bar the same way you set up for your PR. So it makes it autonomous. You don't have to think about something. So oftentimes when you hear people say, I misgroove, it's like, okay, well, what did you misgroove? Your lats weren't tight, or your shoulder blades weren't pinched, or your legs weren't engaged, whatever. Misgrooved, we were joking about this a little bit before, Tony disagrees, but misgrooved to me is a terminology that was used in the multiply and single ply power thing. You had to groove a certain pattern of the shirt or of the suit. So when people fall, you hear them say they misgrooved, it doesn't apply in any way, shape, or form to raw, because you're not in a shirt and you're not in a suit. It just means that you didn't set up properly for that particular rep. It means either you have poor mechanics in your setup in the first place, you set up differently on your heavy sets than you do your light sets, so something went wrong. Or, and if it's in a meet, some people are just freaking crazy nervous and they rush their setup because they're worried about running out of time, or they're worried about the commands. And it's one of the reasons why we always talk about at seminars is train to the same standard of the meet. Don't unrack a bench press and drop the bar down to your chest and go right back up, because that's not what's going to happen to the meet. You're going to have to sit there and hold it for a second, wait for your lift off first to get out of the way, wait for the start command. So I practice that all the time in training, even though my bench sucks. We'll come to that in a little while, Charlie. You're welcome. And so is Paul. But, you know, I will hold the bar out there for a second and wait before I come down to my descent, because that's what a meet's going to be like. So I really try and train to that meet standard, because when you hear people say, oh, I misgrooved it, it's because they never trained that standard in the first place and it throws them off. So somebody who's used to just dropping the bar on the unrack instead of waiting for a start command, it throws them up when they have to hold the weight there for an extra second. They panic, their shoulder comes out, whatever it is. It's just them not holding that position the same way they would for every other rep. You didn't misgroove anything, because it's the same exact bar path, but you weren't holding and stabilizing the position before you started the rep to begin with. And that's what causes that.
Yeah, I mean, it's just technicality, right? Like, You're saying, he's saying misgroove, we're saying didn't hold their technical proficiency within the lift. And a good example of that is your client, and she'll be happy that we've said her name twice now on the episode, referring to the same incident.
Alexis, that bar dump was special.
She did a squat and completely folded underneath the weight because she forgot to brace, which is, I don't know, stupid. But
she's no longer happy you mentioned her.
but then she came back and figured out how to have some competency within the lift, and, you know, got it for a double or a triple or something.
And the following week, which was this week, she actually PR'd her squat by 5 pounds.
Right. So if you look at, like, a side view of that, you know, I wouldn't, the bar path on the way down probably looked almost identical. It's just the fact that it collapsed in the hole because she wasn't able to hold that position. And that's kind of the idea of what we're getting at here, is like, if you misgroove a bench press and you miss that lift because of that, a lot of the times is because you collapse your chest and then you drove it off and you weren't able to hit that same bar path that you normally hit only because you've lost your upper back tightness or you caved on your chest. That's what's causing the issue of the miss. You can call it a misgroove if you don't want to take responsibility for your shitty technical proficiency in the lift. But that's what happens when you lift maximal weight, right? Anything above 90%, one minor mistake is going to cause you to miss that lift for sure. And, you know, it's all semantics, right? I mean, you missed the lift, you came back and got it. I know a lot of times people miss lifts and judges feel a little bit bad for them. So they'll squat a little bit higher on their last one and the judges will give it to them, especially if you're an Iron Rebel athlete and they're judging you. But that was before the current owners. But make sure you support them at the end of the podcast, guys. That way you can get white lights too.
Are we throwing this back to the U.S. Open from 2 years ago?
Yes. That should be their motto. Buy our equipment so you can get white lights too. But yeah, it's all semantics. Misgroove, technical inefficiency. Just make sure that your setup's perfect, and that way you won't have a misgroove.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of slowing things down, being patient, and training that same way. This is not a sport we have to rush. You literally just have to do one repetition, and they're going to get 15 minutes break in between the repetition. We are not the pinnacle of health here. We're the pinnacle of performance, which is just being perfect. You know, like you said, hold your setup, hold your position, hold your pattern, and slow everything down, because slow is stable, stable is strong.
Right, yeah, and even too, like the slower you go, the more force you can produce, as long as you're able to complete that lift in the amount, a lot of time that your body is like, hey, let's stay awake for this lift.
Yep.
You know,
don't pass out before you finish.
Yeah, done that a couple times. Make sure you have good spotters. Jesse Burdick caught me once. It's very, very much the pinnacle of my powerlifting career being held by Jesse.
Many men have wanted the same.
So next question, which is a great question because it bashes on Trevor and excluded me from it, because apparently I said, hey, you know, I don't want to bring this question up because it can relate to me as well. And he's like, no, this doesn't relate to you because you have your priorities changed. I was like, yeah, okay, you're right. I'm weak because my priorities changed, not because I'm just weak. Got it. So the question is, why do some of these amazing coaches who help people progress, set all-time world records, seem to have an issue progressing their own lifts? What's the deal there? Is there a limit on knowledge? Is there a limit on what's genetics maybe? Why can't they seem to progress their own lifts? And the example he used was your bench press, which
yeah,
I don't know what he's talking about. I think your bench press is amazing.
But so technically proficient and yet hurt tremendously weak.
Right. You know, so I think, I mean, genetics, right? Genetics play a big factor in your ability to improve lifts, leverages. There's always going to be lifts that are going to be harder for you, and that takes time. And like we talked about in the opening of the podcast here, is the idea that knowledgeable coaches know everything is just ridiculous, right? Like, yep, it's a constant guessing game, especially with ourselves. If we coach ourselves, it's a constant like back and forth in our own heads of maybe I should do more of this, maybe I should do more of that, why isn't this working? You can be the most proficient lifter in the world as a coach, but it may just take you a while to guess right of what exercises are going to actually build up that lift. Or it just may take you a while to build up a lift, right? Like once you start hitting the genetic threshold of your potential, whether that be you actually reach that potential or whether that be you reach an age where your genetic potential starts to decrease, so it starts to reach your like limits, right? So like, oh, I have a 380-pound bench press, but my genetic potential is 450. Oh, I should have hit that when I was 30. So every year your genetic potential goes down like 10 pounds.
Thanks for giving me the excuse of age there. I appreciate that. So,
but I think that a lot of it just has to do with like, just because you're a great coach and you can help people progress doesn't necessarily mean that you're a bad coach just because you're not progressing. It just means that you haven't quite found those exercises to build that up, or you are so close to that potential that it's going to take a long time to add 5 pounds to your lift. Injuries happen. You know, yeah, Shit happens to where you're going to constantly have this progress regressive pattern. And as you get older and as you get more experience and as you get stronger, the regressiveness of that tends to happen a little bit more and a little bit faster. So you're constantly playing this catch-up game. A lot of times is what happens when the progress starts to stall.
Injuries take the most away from your lift. So, you know, the fastest way to get stronger is to slow down and avoid injuries at any cost. You know, that's what's going to take the most away from the lift. The second you hurt yourself, it's going to be that much harder to get your strength back or go beyond. And it's unfortunately, it's part of the sport a little bit. People do tend to hurt themselves in hopefully a non-significant way. If you do have a significant injury, it does take a lot longer to come back from that. It sets back your training exponentially. My best ever bench, believe it or not, was 395 when I was competing in strongman. And that wasn't even pause, but the 395, my best pause bench is only 380. And some of that had to do with the weight factor. You know, when I was competing in strongman, I did a lot of overhead, a lot of lockout work. And I was also weighing like 240, 245. That was chubby Trevor versus, you know, coming all the way down to 181. I was small Trevor. So I lost a lot of leverage under the bar there. There also has been a lot of like wear and tear on my shoulders over the years. It is a long thing. And I've let a lot of people have it, control of my bench press, my training, my programming. And there are just certain things. I'm a speed guy. So anytime somebody wants me to do soft touch, you know, not sinking, not driving through the legs, and they're like, oh, your arms are getting stronger. And it's like that always just, I end up pulling or shredding a pec and deteriorating. I have to use a lot of leg drive and I have long arms, so it's got a long way to go. I've always done best with inverted volume, just doing bench speed work, not training heavy bench because it wears down my shoulders, just focusing on power and speed and focusing on overhead press because my shoulders and triceps can kick in where my pecs really don't. I'm very explosive and fast at the bottom, but I really do struggle at the top lockout. And I've tried just about everything I can think of and everything everybody else can think of. It's just not going to be a lift that progresses. Now, putting that in perspective, though, I've talked about this at certain seminars and other podcasts. Let's take, for example, someone who took the bench press very quickly, Jeremy Hornstra. Jeremy Hornstra talks about benching like 450 in high school. And in high school, I was the last person to bench press the bar. So he went from 450 to 650, 660. So he gained about 210 pounds on his bench. And I went to 395, 380. I gained 345 pounds on the bench. I would say I made better bench press progress than Jeremy Hornstra. I know it's crazy for some people to take, but my bench press improved over 340 pounds. His bench press only improved 210, 220 pounds. So he took to the lift and so forth. Now, if you also take into account something like full total, because that's what we're judged on, I have a higher sleeve total than he does. And I have a 2 weight classes below him because he focused so much on his bench press and he's achieved all-time world records, but he didn't focus as much on building his squat and building his deadlift and so forth. And the opposite of my problem with longer arms and light body weight is the biggest problem for him. The bigger he got to grow his bench press, the harder deadlift became for someone like him. It didn't, his leverages made it that much harder. He's shorter armed and thicker torso. So really, really long way for him to go with a deadlift. You have to take that in perspective. And now I'm going to give Charlie a little bit of credit here. Charlie has taken the slow grow progress. He keeps making gains year after year, but he started off as just a bencher, but he's focused so much on gaining on his squat and gaining on his deadlift and just relaxing his bench because it was his money lift for a while and not trying to grow it as fast. He's now a high squatter. I don't mean high as in high. I mean like high percentage for his weight class. He's going to be competing at 188 and squatting somewhere between like 722 and 744. And he's going to deadlift around the same, somewhere between, you know, 720 and 740 and bench almost 5. At 188 is going to put him over 1,900 pounds, which is going to put him in the top 20. But he focused on the total program growth, not just his bench growth. If I were to focus only on my bench growth, I would maybe gain, like Tony said, an extra 5 or 10 pounds. But how much more would I lose off my whole total? And to give you another high-level lifter who's an example of that is Kaylor Woolen was a phenomenal deadlifter. And for a while, that's all he was a phenomenal deadlifter. But he's worked really, really hard to bring up his squat pattern and his bench pattern. And now his bench and squat don't come anywhere near his deadlift still. But he's got the all-time world record total or had it for a while at 220 in sleeves because he had that money lift, which was his deadlift. But he focused so much on building up his squat and his bench press to kind of come up. They didn't have to come up far. They just had to come up to where they're mediocre. And I'm not calling him a mediocre lifter. But what I'm saying is because his deadlift was so fantastic, by bringing his squat up, I think he squatted 644 in sleeves, which at 220 is not like an outstanding squat, but it's not a bad squat at all. And I know he benched, I want to say about 440 or maybe 450, which is also a decent, you know, 220 squat, but it's not exceptional. Like an exceptional 220 bencher is benching over 500. An exceptional squatter is squatting 700 sleeves. Like let's look at Jeremy Lin squatting 700 in sleeves and Jake and Joe Sullivan. These guys are all squatting over 700 in sleeves. He didn't have to do that because he had the 950-pound pull. You only had to bring him up a little bit. So you have to decide what's the best course of action to improve your overall total. As a powerlifter, that's what we're ranked by is your overall total, not your individual lift. So for me, I don't spend a lot of time on building my bench because it doesn't affect my overall total as much as my deadlift and my squat.
I'm wondering when you're ever going to actually answer the question.
I had to get all that out there.
The question is, how come some really good coaches aren't that great at lifters?
Well,
because you have
I was ranked number 4 all time at 81 and number 5 all time at 98.
Look, so true. Mr. Ego, just because he used you as an example doesn't mean you're the only coach he wants to know.
However, I was ranked like 4,000th at bench.
There are, without naming any names, because I don't want coaches to, you know, it's not an attack on them, but there are really good coaches that are really not the greatest powerlifters at all. So it's like, well, why is that the case, you know? And I think it happens a lot with, USAPL coaches, more so than it happens with enhanced coaches. So I think a lot of enhanced coaches are actually decently strong for the most part, but USAPL coaches that are really good and produce some of the best athletes in the world aren't necessarily as strong as themselves, but they have all this knowledge. So what's going on here? Like, why is that the case? Why is that the experience, you know? And I mean, I can say probably one, if you're going to be a really good coach, you may not be able to be the best athlete in the world because you're trying to be a really good coach. Like, you only have a finite amount of effort you can put into things. You may think that that's silly, like programming and coaching and putting effort into your athletes. Why would that take away your ability to actually be a competitive athlete? Because it's fucking hard when you want to be good at it, right? You put a lot of time and effort, and that's stress that's not going to necessarily help with your recovery. And sometimes you're just not that fucking good at a sport that you love. I love watching football. I used to love playing football. Never going to fucking make it in the NFL, right? But that doesn't mean I couldn't be a good coach if I wanted to be a good coach. Because learning the X's and O's and learning the dynamics of what makes someone stronger and what makes someone faster and all this other stuff has nothing to do with your genetic potential and your ceiling for where you can go. So I think that's what happens to a lot of them. A lot of coaches love the process of coaching so much, and they realize to a certain extent, like, hey, maybe I'm not going to be the best athlete in the world. Not that big of a deal. I can be the best coach in the world. I can control that. And I think for coaches, especially ones that like to do the research and like to always constantly improve, they like to have control of things, right? I can control the effort and the knowledge and everything that I'm putting into my body to give to my athletes. But if I show up to the gym and I'm doing everything perfect, I can't necessarily control the fucking improvements that I want to see, right? So I think that plays a big role. And I just think like a lot of the best coaches, whether it's bodybuilding, I was just talking about this the other day, the New York pros in Tampa. And I got to quit talking kind of shit about the gyms I go to, because I don't have the gyms to go to. All the gyms that I go to in Tampa, I love the gyms. I think you guys are all great. I just like to talk shit. Just let me talk shit. Please don't kick me out of your gym. But the Tampa pros this weekend, and there was a bunch of bodybuilders at this gym that I go to. And I was looking at the coaches. I'm like these guys look like they've never lifted weights a day in their life. They're a little bit pudgy. And you're like, man, why are these coaches not the best bodybuilders, right?
Now, the more you focus on the athletes, the harder it is to focus on yourself. You have to give up. You have to make a sacrifice. And usually it's your own training time, your own recovery, your own program. We talked about this weekend, like, we showed up unannounced at Elite Strength Conditioning on Saturday to work out, just so we didn't have to interact with a lot of athletes. And I didn't want to be unfair to athletes. I actually do coach athletes in that gym, and I love Scott. But if people know I'm coming, they're going to want my time. And it means I can't train, and they're going to want to interact, which is cool. I'm good with social interaction, or I'm trying to be anyways. But it's one of those things where the more you coach, the less you have for yourself. So it is getting harder and harder for me to train and maintain that level and progress. It is getting exponentially harder.
Right. So I think that's really the biggest thing that it comes down to, Charlie, is just, you know, your ability to spread yourself very thin doesn't necessarily correlate to being the best athlete in the world. The best athletes aren't always the best coaches. The best athletes that become coaches are usually trying to rip you off to build off of their athletic prowess to make a little bit of money, but they're shitty coaches. We've seen that all the time too. So the one-to-one correlation doesn't necessarily always exist. I think, you know, some coaches can be top 10 and still be great coaches, but that's going to drastically shift as they get older because priorities change. And that's my excuse, right? Priorities change.
Your priorities change. That's why you're weak.
Charlie, that's what Charlie said, man.
Although both Tony and I were warmed up and lifting and under the bar in 7 minutes this weekend, to the chagrin of Scott, who likes to spend 30 minutes frolicking on the floor.
I did not say that. Please don't take that out of the gym.
Scott, I love you, Scott, and I'm going to buy your rack. So don't get mad at me, but it's so true. We couldn't believe we were under the bar in 7 minutes.
Yeah.
He's like, look, I got to check the film. He's like, I can't believe it. I'm like, yep, it's there.
Yeah, I mean, which brings up a great point, right? Like the idea of a warm-up is contextual to where you're at within your dynamics of like progression, right? Like, I'm active. I do other things outside of powerlifting that have me moving around and being flexible and being mobile. I don't need to fucking warm up, right? Like, I walked from the goddamn AC of my car to the 100-degree heat. I'm like, I'm warm. That walk warmed me up.
Tony's bougie car, when you pulled up, Scott was like, I didn't realize he was bougie. I'm like, he's not, just the car. He's like modest everywhere else, just the car.
But it's like, yeah, I mean, it's all context dependent. Like Carlos says it best. Once Carlos started making sure he got X amount of steps in a day and started making sure that he moved more than he sat, his warm-ups diminished.
Yeah.
You know, people who, and it's also the idea of like, what I feel like I need to, this the confirmation bias as well. It's like, I feel like I need to do X, Y, and Z before I can get under the bar. So thus I must do X, Y, and Z, or else my risk of injury is going to be exponentially higher, you know? And then they feel like every time they come to the gym, they have to do that or they're going to get injured. And then on top of that, the thing that I saw that you do, cause I didn't really warm up at all. I think I did one set of hip airplanes. I was like, oh, I feel pretty good. Good.
It was a great set of hip airplanes.
Yeah, yeah, it was good. When you started warming up, your intent was, I want to warm up as efficiently as possible, as fast as possible, and get under the bar. One of our other friends, who I won't say her name because she'll get mad, tends to kind of like be on her phone a little bit as she's warming up, and then, you know, do a little bit of this and then get back on her phone and then do a little bit of that. And it's like 30 minutes later, it's like, fuck, your warm up really took 8 minutes, but you extended it to 30. And I think that's what happens to a lot of people. Their intent when they come to the gym is, I'm going to warm up. Where your intent was like, I want to train. Let me get this fucking warm up out of the way so I can train. And your warm up integrated into your training, which is something that Jordan Shallow talks about all the time, is, you know, you should be able to pick 4 exercises and do those exercises, get under the bar, do those exercises, get under the bar with a plate. And that's it. It's all integrated. It shouldn't be, this is my warm-up section. I got my foam roller here. I got my fucking pillow, my blanket, my lacrosse ball, a couple bands, a yoga mat. And it's like, then you get on the yoga mat and it's like, you lay down for like 10 minutes and you like do some rolling around shit. And it's like, you're not there to actually start training. You're probably doing yourself more of a disservice by being in that mindset of like, oh, I just got to relax a little bit before I start training. Like, what the fuck?
I don't roll anything. Yeah. My first exercise was squats. So I just, you know, I did some stability work with like bird dogs and planks. And then I got to, you know, just like some Cossack stuff, getting loose and warm, hip airplanes, just like you. And I was into the bar and I reassessed. I'm like, does anything feel tight? Yeah. My lats felt tight. So I stretched my lats and I was ready to go. That was it. It took me all 7 minutes.
I mean, that's the whole idea, right? You should literally be able to get under the bar, do a couple of squats and be like, okay, this doesn't feel right. Let me do this. You have to assess. The idea that you have to do X, Y, and Z every time you come to the gym is ridiculous. You're just wasting
time. In the day, we called it movement prep. And, you know, if you were a trainer, that was, you did your movement prep. And movement prep is just preparation for that first movement. It shouldn't take very long at all. So if you have like 30 minutes of movement prep. I got
bastardized by people like Keto Portal, where it's like movement gurus doing the fucking jungle yoga, the tiger yoga.
Well, specific to what they want to do. Like, if you want to be a floor acrobat, then you need to do that Ido Portal shit, you know?
That's what I'm going to start working on. Floor acrobats. Here I come.
If you want to be a powerlifter, you just have to be able to move the bar from point A to point B and move it efficiently. That's it.
Yeah.
You don't need to be a circus monkey.
No, definitely not. All right. You know, I don't like this question, but I know you do. And mainly because I don't think handlers are necessary. It's fucking powerlifting. You don't need someone to handle you. handle your emotions when you bomb out. That's about it.
But you were the calmest person I've ever seen bomb out. You're like, yeah, I didn't have it today. And I was like, I'm just fucking lifting,
man. I'm not doing anything crazy. I enjoy lifting, whether I get the lift or not. I'm still having fun. But anyways, question is.
Yeah, get the question up first before I break this down.
Yeah. What would being a great handler entail? Attempt selection, extra gear, etc. I'm going to pass this on to you, because I don't want to start answering this and then people are like, oh, can you handle me at meets? No, no, I will not.
All right. So I was at a meet once and I had 17 athletes competing over 3 days. And I was also competing and I cut weight for this meet.
Jesus Christ.
And I had a guy tell me, yeah, I'm a little nutty, but I had a guy complaining in the back. He's like, you know why I'm not doing well? Because I don't have anybody handle. And I'm like, dude, I'm handling 17 athletes over 3 days. I cut weight and I'm still competing. And ain't nobody fucking handling me. First, if you're in sleeves, you don't need a handler at all. You don't need a handler at all if you're in sleeves. That's the biggest piece of bullshit I've ever heard, that you need a handler if you're in sleeves. If you're getting wrapped, absolutely, you probably are going to do better with somebody wrapping you if you're used to that wrapping in the first place. That doesn't hurt to have somebody wrapping you. What does a handler do? So, you know, the less responsible you are and the less responsibility we have, if you bring in a handler, they're wrapping you, reminding you to eat in between temps, and maybe going to the putting in your attempts in form. So you want to have those attempts worked out ahead of time. And I always tell people, when it comes to attempt selection, you're going to have your opener. You should be able to hit that for a triple with Ebola, maybe even halfway to death. I don't care. But you should be able to hit your opener regardless, because it's just your last warm-up. It's to get you into the meet. If you're opening at a PR, you're probably stupid. No, I'm going to guarantee you're stupid if you open at a PR. So I'm going to put that out there.
Facts.
It doesn't matter what you open with. It's what you finish with that matters. So it's last warm-up. Whatever you want. Yeah, the only thing you want to get to is what you're going to work up to. So open at something easy enough. It's last warm-up. Then have a high, medium, and low, or low, medium, high, whoever your brain works, for second and third attempts based on how the first one felt. So if you get up the platform and you're like, man, that felt like shit, take your low effort for your second one, or your medium effort. Don't go to the high automatically. But we're going to throw this at Charlie, by the way. Charlie's not allowed to pick his third attempts, because every time he does, he misses. So I'm going to pick that shit for him. I'm going to handle Charlie on meet day, or make sure that Bree does it for me. But so we'll have numbers ahead of time. But your handler can go to the table, but there's not really much for them to do. You know, you don't need someone to hold chalk for you. You don't need someone to hold your ammonia for you. You don't need someone to remind you to eat. You're a grown up. You're an adult. This is not a youth sport. You know, most of us have been doing this a little while. You don't need a handler. If you feel like you need a handler, you're not confident in yourself. I'm going to put that out there. If you feel like you need a handler and you're outside of wraps, you're just not confident in yourself. If you want someone to go over and watch the clock for you, or put in your attempts for you, that's fine. Just make sure you really specify that's what you want. Because I've had people do that where, like, I have a handler, they're going to watch the clock for me. And they actually timed out because the handler was talking to somebody else during that process and didn't realize they were up. So that's one of the reasons why I have a kid who's done it like twice. You know, he's like missed attempts twice because his handler never knew that. You know, give him like a 2-minute warning. It's like, you're your own person. You have to learn to be self-reliable and self-responsible. It's great to have your teammates and your friends there. And they can be, hey, dude, you know, you're 3 out. Like, I will do that. Like at the hybrid meet, I let everyone who's sitting there getting wrapped or know whether they were my athlete or somebody else's athlete. I'm like, you're 4 out, you're 5 out, you're 6 out. Because I want to be able to control that clock and the process and know when it needs to wrap my guy. I want to know who's in wraps or sleeves before them, so how much time I have. I want to pay attention at the table so I know if someone's scratched on a second or third attempt, because it's going to move the clock up faster for the person. Like, I will watch that clock. As a coach, I will do that. But as an athlete, you don't really need that. That just means you're like trying to have an excuse, a built-in excuse to blame somebody else. My handler didn't do this, or I didn't have that. That's on you to bring all those things. You have to bring all the gear you're going to need. You have to bring extra liquids, extra drinks. If you have different knee sleeves, the second pair of socks, a second singlet, whatever it is, that's all on you to bring. It's not on your handler to remind you what you need on meet day. You should be so prepared for this ahead of time. You have it all listed, checklisted, written out with you. And you should be able to go up to the table and confidently say, I'm taking 686 for my next attempt or whatever. You really shouldn't need to have somebody in there. But if you feel nervous around numbers, then you have someone put them in for you. You know, have your low, medium, and high, and have that person objectively look at the speed you're moving and go put in that next attempt for you. If you're nervous and you don't want to do that, that's cool. But you don't really need a handler per se. I mean, I don't understand what a handler.
The guy who didn't bring his shoes to his last powerlifting meet.
It was RPS. I was able to deadlift barefoot. It was so cool and scary at the same time, because I felt like I was gonna slide around the floor. But at the same time, you know, I was offered shoes by like 5 different people. I'm like, I don't want to put your shoes on.
Yeah, that's gross.
I'm going to take my chances with the barefoot.
Yeah.
But, you know, I was so focused on when I was squatting for that meet. So I had like 2 pairs of knee wraps. I had my squat shoes, I had my squat singlet. And I was just having a good time during the meet. It was like the first time I didn't have too many athletes in the meet. I think it was just Jordan and myself doing it, and Joe. I think it was like three of us. So it wasn't that big a deal. It was unusual for me.
Yeah.
But you don't need a handler. You just need to be self-responsible.
Right. To piggyback off of that, I'm not going to give any advice because I don't want to handle anyone ever. But mainly because I don't want somebody fucking running up to me, hugging me after. Because you guys all stink when you lift. You probably may have shit yourself or pissed yourself. I don't need to be dealing with that.
I could beat on by a couple of ladies.
Yeah. Fucking.
Some people pay for that.
Yeah. I'll hug you after you shower and we go out to eat afterwards. Maybe. I'm not much of a hugger. But I think the idea of like, you'd hug Trevor if we're ever together. He can accept all hugs. Go through Trevor, please. But the idea of responsibility, right? I see this happen so many times. People go to meets and at least every meet that I've gone to, somebody fucks it up because they've relied on other people. And they just quit using their fucking brain. I've seen it. I've seen where the meet directors switched up flight attempts and the athlete didn't even bother to check. They showed up like an hour late thinking they were in the last flight. And, oh, guess what? They moved up a flight. Oh, now I got to warm up. I got to go straight to my opener from fucking walking into the arena. It's like, man, you know, take some responsibility for your actions, for your prep, right? You've put however many weeks into this, dedicated, you know, 5 hours a day in the gym when it only should have taken you an hour and a half. And then you talk about how you can't power lift because it's so time consuming. That's another thing I don't ever get. But anyways, I digress. You know, be proud of the work you put in and then take ownership of that work and just fucking carry out the stuff. I think the idea of having a handler puts it on such a pedestal sometimes too, that you make yourself super nervous because then you're like, oh, now I got to perform well because, you know, my favorite lifter, my favorite coach, Trevor Jaffe, he's going to handle me. And if I don't do well, he's going to think I'm stupid. And it's like, well, guess what? He probably thinks you're stupid already. He just hasn't told you yet. But
fake news, fake news. Where's my fact checker?
But I think, still love yeah, you. I think listen, the whole personal responsibility thing is huge.
Yeah, I mean, be personally responsible. Know what you're supposed to lift. Know what you're supposed to bring. Have everything. If the meet starts at 9, then you need to be there at 9. I don't care if it's third flight, fifth flight, D, flight D, F, doesn't matter. Be there at 9, and it's such a rookie move to not look at the sheet and see what your spot is on the flight and what the opener is to make sure it matches what it's supposed to be. Yeah. Anyone who doesn't do that or claims not to do that is literally just dumb. They're dumb. You should always go in there and make sure because, like you said, after doing 30 plus meets, I've seen people shift from flight B to flight A because people didn't show up after weigh-ins and they just don't get down. It does happen. Yeah. So if the meet starts at 9, you're there at 9. Check your flight order, make sure everything's correct. You have up until the start of that flight to change it, make sure everything's proper. If you haven't done that, that's on you.
Yeah. And if you do have a handler and you have a shitty day, don't fucking make it awkward. Don't be sitting there talking shit. It's just goddamn lifting weights. Trust me, you'll be able to lift weights again another day and you'll be able to compete. Don't fucking ruin it for everyone else.
Yeah. Well, you know, people get pretty emotionally invested. I get emotionally invested, but you don't want to have that. It's going to happen. There's a high likelihood that you're going to have a bad meet. Very few people. I don't know anyone who's ever gone 9 for 9 in every single meet they've done. You're going to go wrong.
I've never gone 9 for 9. But
I haven't either.
Yeah, my thought process is like, well, what if that's the last meet you ever get to do, right? Are you just going to have this shitty memory of it? If half your time powerlifting is spent having shitty memories because things didn't go the way you want to because you have unrealistic expectations and you never enjoy the time that you have competing, the fuck's the point of doing it, right? I don't know. It just blows my mind when people do poorly at meets and then it just affects their entire day. And they're just assholes. And you're like,
that's someone whose self-worth is tied to their total.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. They haven't built life up outside of their total. I mean, it's great if you've achieved an amazing total. That's what we're all trying to do is trying to improve our total and PR things. And it's great to do that. But if you tie your actual self-worth to just what you do on the platform, you're going to have a very long rest of your life after you're done competing and you have no substance there. So you have to build things up simultaneously. Yeah. And just like Tony said, don't at the end of the day, it is just lifting weights. You don't see a football team like going and hanging themselves if they lost the Super Bowl. Yeah, they're sad. They want to come back, but they're going to laugh themselves to sleep with their millions of dollars and come back next year.
Guaranteed they're going out partying that night.
Aren't we getting that?
I did a podcast with Phil DeRue, who's a high level MMA strength conditioning coach, and he coaches Joanna Jojinczyk. And if you say that name real fast, you don't fuck it up. I guarantee you. And her last fight was, you know, one of the best fights in that I've ever seen.
That's a great fight.
But her face got like just like it was the biggest hematoma I've ever seen in my life. And Phil said she lost that fight. She got her face beat up pretty bad. She was still out partying, having a good time with everyone that helped her get there. Right. It's like, oh, that's the way it should be. Whether you win or lose, as long as you put forth the effort, who gives a fuck what happens?
That's what you should be proud of, is the discipline, the effort you put forth. You know, you put something special together. But when you're at a meet, you're going to have friends there, or it's, you know, an atmosphere, you're developing relationships. If you plan on coaching, you're going to see how other coaches interact with their athletes and learn from them. There's so much more to take away from that than just your total.
Yeah, for sure. Okay, next question. I would love to hear more about how you guys balance coaching new versus experienced lifters in terms of not giving one more attention than the other. This is something I saw at the last and only seminar that you guys were able to put on because coronavirus, son of a bitch. That was the government's way of stopping our seminars. They were too powerful.
They're trying to shut us down.
Yeah, we treated, you know, 100-pound deadlifters the same as 800-pound deadlifters, which I don't think there was any 800-pound deadlifters there. Carlos hasn't pulled 800 yet.
Seven.
You're close.
I pulled it.
In competition?
No, not in competition. I pulled it in gym.
Your goddamn training house.
My last meet prep besides this one, I pulled 795 on kilos and then tore my adductor next week. There's nothing I could do about that.
That's true. So why do we treat everyone the same? Because deep down inside, you're all the same.
You're all the same.
Whether you're the all-time world record holder or you're someone who just wants to do their first powerlifting meet, you hired me as a coach. You came to our seminar. You paid the same price as the other person. So we're going to treat you all the same. You guys have the expectation of getting the best coaching experience. And we as coaches who actually value ourselves as coaches, we want to make sure that we treat everyone the same. We want to make sure that you feel like you're getting the same amount of coaching and the same amount of friendship and the same amount of everything that this other person's getting, because one, that's what you paid for, and two, that's just who we are as people. Our goal is to help you. Our goal is not to put "we coach all-time world record holders" by our name. None of that shit matters. We want to help as many people as possible. And if we think that we're only going to want to help the best lifters in the world, well, guess what? We're going to run out of fucking, we're not going to have the best business in the world first.
That's the 1%. They're not the ones that are out there.
And they're the cheapest motherfuckers out there too.
Yeah, some of them. But it really falls upon the athlete's communication level. You know, we're at a seminar, they're all there at the same time, they're all communicating, they're all raising their hands with questions and breaking it down. But unfortunately, outside of a seminar, you don't always get that from an individual coaching client. They don't always communicate or tell you things. I have some people who will send me one video a month if I'm lucky, if I get that. And I have other people who don't tell me when a meet is. And it's certainly like, they're like, what are my openers going to be in 3 weeks? I'm like, did you email me your meet? Because text messages get lost. DMs get lost. When I spend 2 hours going through all those after a time, and I'm very systemized. I'm like, listen, you must email me anything that's going to change or alter the way you're programmed so I can notate it and write it down. It's not going to happen in a text message when I'm scrolling through my phone. And sometimes you have people who will, you know, message you every day or every other day or however your coach works. So you'll get the level of experience to the level you communicate with your coach.
That's not answering the goddamn question.
It is answering the question.
They're asking you why you, as Trevor Jaffe, treat people the same.
Everyone's the same. But what I'm saying is you can get more out of the coaching experience the more you communicate to the coach. Now, at a seminar, they were all there interacting together.
That's not the question. The question is, why are you a nice guy? Why do you treat people the same? We've already talked about communication as an athlete and a coach several times.
It's so important.
We beat the dead horse on that.
Listen, a PR is a PR. It doesn't matter if you've been lifting for 1 month or you've been lifting for 10 years. If I can get you to have a better technique, a more efficient pattern, and PR your lift, I'm just as proud of that, and you're just as proud of that. That PR to you meant the exact same as that PR to the all-time world record holder.
Exactly.
It's the same thing. It is a PR for you. So, and that's what we're competing against in the sport is ourselves. So, you know, treat everyone with the level they treat you. So if someone's coming to you with respect, treat you with respect and looking to learn, you're going to give that all for them. If they don't respect your time and don't treat it, it's very hard to do that. And in a seminar, everyone's respecting your time. They're very polite. They're answering, they're asking questions and allowing you to interact. And that's one of the reasons, like when we had our seminar there, that's the first thing we did is we asked everybody, and I do it at every seminar, I ask everyone what they're hoping to take away from the day so I can make sure I touch on that topic for them because that is why they're there.
Right. I mean, when I used to coach athletes, it was the same kind of thing, right? Like I had guys that were at the college level. I had guys that were in the high school level. I had a couple guys that were the pros. And if they had the same training slot time, if they were doing something very similar with their training styles, they just trained together. Right? It wasn't, oh, you're in the NFL, you're going to get special treatment. It's like, why? You know, is it going to be better? No, probably not, right? The idea that you're in a competitive environment, the idea that you're around other people that look up to you, is probably going to make you fucking work a lot harder. And that's one of the things, too, that always drives me is the reputation that you're trying to build can be tarnished so fast by you just being an asshole. And it's like, I want to work as hard as I can to help as many people as I can as possible. And that require that sense of respect that I want to garnish because of that, I put on myself. Like I have this higher level of standards that I want to have for myself. And that just accentuates into the athletes, you know? And
yep.
And like you said, it is important, right? Like if you're a lifter who is not enthusiastic, who always has negative check-ins, you know, it's not as enjoyable from a coach's experience, right? But if you're full of enthusiasm, if you're asking really good questions, if you're doing your own research and you're fucking on top of things, that's fucking exciting for a coach. So if you want the best out of your coach, like Trevor was saying, be excited, you know, be.
Well, now you're coming back to what I'm saying.
Yeah. Because I wanted you to actually answer
shit
the question.
Shit on me first and then agree in second.
I wanted you to actually answer the question, you know, but if you want the most.
Everybody's equal. That's as simple as it is. Everybody's absolutely equal under the bar. Your PR means the same to you as it does for the ultimate world record.
Right.
The bar doesn't discriminate at all.
You look at the best coaches, you know, yeah, I would say there's definitely favoritism in the real sports, right? Like Michael Jordan was probably had a little bit more favoritism shown towards him. He got away with a little bit more things. That happens. But I think at the end of the day, good coaches know everyone on their rosters. Good coaches go out of their way to talk to rookies, talk to free agents the same way they talk to their star players a lot of times. And I think that's the way it should be. Like you should get to know your people. You should want to help them. And I think the more you get to know them, the more you want to help them as well, because you start to develop a relationship with that person. And sure. I think that's what it comes down to. Coaches are building relationships. And once you build that relationship, you're going to want to help them even more.
I have athletes who I don't coach anymore who still reach out for help with either their own individual clients or own individual issues, even though I'm not currently their coach, because I've established that relationship with them. You know, I wasn't necessarily the right coach for them for the long term, but they understand that I can help them still.
I have fucking athletes who I've been told steal my program and give it to their athletes. And I still coach that motherfucker. I still coach those people because I don't care. At least they're getting decent programming.
I said the same thing. You know, it's complimentary. It's flattering that they know that, you know, and for most people, the majority of the program is going to help 80% of the people if they're intermediate or beginner stage anyways.
It's like we're doing something fucking special. We're all having squats, bench press, and deadlifts in your program. Like,
nothing special? Nothing special?
Yeah, yeah. Every time I talk on this podcast, I lose more and more clients because they're just like, oh, Tony doesn't have any secrets. Oh, Tony doesn't like to communicate.
All right, so new marketing tactic. We have all the secrets. We're only sharing half of the stuff with you. DM me for a special code.
Yes, and I'll give you my phone number so we can text like we're best friends.
He's lying. There's only like 12 people that have his phone number. It took me like 12 years to get his phone number.
Yeah.
Riley got 12 days. What's up with that? You have a thing for the ladies. That's what it is.
I think I had her phone number because I needed to get a hold of her because you don't ever fucking text me back.
That's true. That's probably also true.
One last question because it'll be a quick one. At what point would you accept / embrace a lifter pulling with a flex lumbar? Never.
Kyphotic upper back is totally fine. It gives you extra reach. It shortens your range of motion. A flexed lumbar probably is not going to be ideal in the long term. If you're in a flexed lumbar position and you're loading it, you do increase your likelihood of some type of lumbar pathology. I can't blanketly say that it's going to cause injury, because in some people they're outliers, it doesn't. So just like the scientific discussion we had in the beginning, but it's probably not ideal, you know, neutral zone. It's not a perfect, you know, pelvic tuck, rip, things like that. So it's probably more ideal to have a stable lumbar when you're deadlifting. Yeah. So I'm going to say, if you can maintain stability with some level of flexion, great. But chances are you're going into flexion because you're not maintaining stability. That's what most commonly causes that posterior pelvic tilt, is because you're lacking bracing in the torso and stability, and your body is using that as a compensation pattern. So it's not ideal. Recognize it's compensation. Work to improve torso strength. If you want to round your kyphotic upper back, you know, if you want to go the kyphosis around your shoulders, that's totally fine. I probably wouldn't suggest starting with a rounded lumbar spine.
Yeah, I mean, not only is your risk of injury going to be increased, but your risk of force production is going to be dramatically decreased. So, you know, you don't want any weak links within any type of force production, especially through your core, your magical core. But yeah, easy one. You don't want it. But having some type of flexion in your back is not that big of a deal, as long as it's not coming from your lower back, like Trevor said. But don't necessarily fucking is it a Norwegian deadlift that Jay Nair?
The Finnish.
Yeah. Don't fucking show up your first day at the gym and be like, I want to do a Finnish deadlift, because Jay Nair looks like a goddamn cannonball when he does it. Don't do that, guys. Don't do that. So
yeah, the Finnish deadlift posterior tailbone tuck, it is not excessively posterior, and they're able to maintain that rigid pattern as they do it. So it's something they train to accomplish.
Yeah. So great questions, guys. Really appreciate them. Thank you so much. If you like the show, please go to iTunes, leave a review and a 5-star rating. You can check it out on YouTube as well, just under Coach's Corner, which there's a couple of them, those sons of bitches.
Yeah, I looked. So look for Team Phoenix Performance. You'll find it.
Yeah. So check it out. Also, make sure you check out Trevor and Riley's podcasts. Successory something or another.
The Successory Show. Success in Life and Sport.
Okay, that's too much. Can we give me an acronym next time, please?
Sorry. We're just going to call it the SS.
No, because then you're getting into the neo-Nazi stuff again. Can't do that.
This is how rumors get started.
Yeah,
Trevor's part of the SS.
Back away. But make sure you check out their show. It's on Spotify. It's also on YouTube. And it'll be on all the streaming stuff here soon.
It's approved. It's on iTunes now and everything. Yeah,
check it out. Good to go. Leave reviews. Really good show. Not a bunch of two idiots rambling on about questions and answers. Just one idiot. And
just one idiot.
Riley. So congratulations to her. And also check out Subject Zero Supplements. We have t-shirts now on the website. Brian, if you listen to this and you want a tank top, let me know what brand of tank tops you like. And maybe we can make that happen. But if you don't listen to the show, you're fucked. So that's your fault.
First, he's fucked for wanting a tank top. Dude, put some sleeves on. You're a powerlifter, not a bodybuilder. Knock it off.
He's a strongman guy.
Even worse.
He's
why is he walking around in a tank top? He's a strongman guy.
He's recovering from bicep surgery too, so it's not even going to look that good.
Oh, is it that Brian B-Benzel? Brian Benzel?
Yeah. Pro strongman. If he wants a fucking tank top, he can have a tank top. He's way bigger than me.
He's one step away from Crop Top Tuesday.
That is true. He probably does. But yeah, check out Subject Zero, t-shirts, supplements, all that stuff backed by science. Even the t-shirts guaranteed to add
some science
to your bench press, at least. That's going to be – Trevor's going to hit a bench PR because he's wearing a Subject Zero shirt. Might not be approved by USPA because it's so anabolic, or USAPL. Check out Iron Rebel, especially if you want to get white lights. Also check out Metrolife and Ritual Apparel and Renaissance Periodization, all that good stuff. They support mostly Trevor. Actually, all of them support Trevor for the most part. None of them support me, but it's fine. No hard feelings over here.
Subject Zero supports you. Or in reverse. Support yourself. Zero.
Anything else you want to, any words of wisdom you want to leave the listeners with?
I have no words. I just thank them for listening to us ramble about bullshit every week.
I appreciate it. Thank you guys. As always, keep asking the questions. We'll keep doing our best to answer them and hopefully not insult anyone. If you feel insulted by the podcast in any way, shape, or form, just understand we're idiots. We're morons. We're just having fun talking shit. We don't really have any negative thoughts or opinions on anyone, really. Yeah.
Just everybody love everybody.
Yeah. There you go. All right. I'll talk to you next week, man.
Sounds good. Nobody pray for me. It been a day for me.
Yeah. Yeah. Hey, I remember syrup sandwiches and crime allowances. Vanessa Nickel.